The following was made as a television videotape. Its purpose is to provide orientation for those teaching the CHEM Study course.
You're used to discussing the subject of equilibrium, surely to include Le Chatelier's principle. How is the CHEM Study course liable to differ in this subject? Well, there are probably two respects. First, the subject is developed in great detail on a molecular level. We wish the student to have a view of the dynamic nature of equilibrium on this molecular level. Second, we develop the subject more quantitatively than perhaps you are used to, in terms of the equilibrium constant. We're going to see now the film Equilibrium, and the purpose of this film in the course is to introduce the student to equilibrium not as a static, macroscopic phenomenon, but as a dynamic, microscopic phenomenon. This film presents us with an up-to-date, microscopic view of chemical reactions. It allows the student to think about the conditions of equilibrium in terms of dynamic processes that are going on. Let me give you a couple of examples from the film. We saw, for instance, solid iodine dissolving in organic solvents to give a solution. On the other hand, all of the solid did not dissolve. It finally reached a condition in which some solid iodine remained, and solid iodine was obvious in solution. And at this stage, the student will understand that he's reached a dynamic situation in which the rate at which the process of dissolving occurs is just equal to the reverse rate at which precipitation occurs. Here's another example of a chemical reaction which was not in the film. Consider the reaction in which calcium carbonate decomposes to give calcium oxide solid plus carbon dioxide gas. This reaction proceeds in a closed container, calcium carbonate decomposing to produce calcium oxide and raising the pressure of carbon dioxide in the container. Finally, however, the pressure of carbon dioxide reaches a constant value, and the student will easily understand that this is characterized by that situation in which the reverse reaction, carbon dioxide plus calcium oxide, is forming calcium carbonate at the same rate at which the decomposition is occurring. This dynamic view of equilibrium permits then the student to understand more than just the existence of equilibrium, but to see what factors are involved. Now, one of these factors that's involved in fixing the state of equilibrium is the factor which is called tendency to minimum energy. This is a familiar idea, and one has no difficulty convincing the student it should be a factor. He's familiar with the fact that that a ball will roll downhill and find the minimum position, the minimum potential energy. However, it's also easy to show him and convince him, with the aid of this view of equilibrium, that that cannot be the only factor. For example, consider the solid iodine dissolving to form solution. In this reaction, actually, we find that heat is absorbed. So as solid dissolves, it's definitely not proceeding to a state of minimum energy. Quite the opposite. The energy is being absorbed, going to a state of higher energy. There must be some other factor than tendency to minimum energy involved. Consider this reaction. If we mix calcium oxide and carbon dioxide, it forms calcium carbonate. On the other hand, if we begin with pure calcium carbonate, it decomposes to give calcium oxide and carbon dioxide. Plainly, the reaction can't proceed in both directions toward minimum energy. Again, there must be some other factor operative besides tendency to minimum energy that causes equilibrium to be reached. Now, the other factor is randomness, and this is not treated in the traditional chemistry course at high school, but in fact, there's no reason not to treat it, because the idea is actually very familiar and intuitively easily accepted. Consider this experiment, which permits the student to develop some expectations from his everyday life. Here I have a group of counters. Each one has a white and a dark side. And consider the likely answers you'd get from your students if you ask them, what will be the effect if I shake this box? Will I be likely to find all of the counters with their dark side up after I reopen the box? Now, you know as well as I that no student is going to answer that he will expect to find all the dark sides up. He will expect to find some light and some dark. And of course, inevitably, that's the case. Now, you realize that this is a situation in which there is no tendency for minimum energy. The entire question was independent of energy. And this gives him an opportunity to see that he can make decisions of a factor operative when there is no energy factor. Now, we can also use this type of example to show what happens when you have a competition between an energy factor and this randomness factor that was just demonstrated. You see, I have this box on a tilt, and consequently, we see that there is an energy factor tending to bring the particles down to the bottom of the box. Now, suppose I agitate this, then we will see that the particles move throughout the box. Now, the agitation is the analogous factor to temperature in chemical systems. And we see that the two factors that are important in determining chemical equilibrium are the tendency to minimum energy and the tendency to maximum randomness. And the tendency to maximum randomness is implemented by the temperature. The higher the temperature, the more randomness will dictate the result. And finally, we'll see that equilibrium will come about where there is an exact balance between the tendency to maximum randomness, which is that in the solution, and the tendency to minimum energy, that in the solid. At equilibrium, these two factors have become equal.